Hey, Merry Christmas. It's great to see you all out tonight. I hope you have had a good evening so far. How many of you have already opened your presents for Christmas? Raise your hand. Okay, how many have done part of your presents? Okay, how many haven't done any yet? Okay, then you got tomorrow to look forward to, don't you? All right? Well, that is terrific. I love Christmas time. And I love Christmas Eve night, and I love spending part of it with you. So thank you for coming out and spending it with us. It's great to have you, with us this year. We're going to open a little bit differently than normal. I'm going to draw your attention to the screen behind me. We're going to dim the lights here in just a minute, and we're going to kick off with a video. This was sent to me. How many of you remember Joe Crawford? Be a few of you. He was our former youth pastor here. All right. For 5 years, I had the oldest youth pastor in the state of California. When he left me to move Southern California as the oldest youth pastor, he still served 15 more years as a youth pastor. He just retired, all right? He moved to Colorado, and guess what he's looking for? He's looking for another church he can go help the youth program out in, all right? Let's see here. He's 9 years older than I am. That puts him past 70, all right? So, anyway, he sent me this, and I was so, and I know the setting of this is World War II. That's the setting. But I think all of you kids are just going to love this music, all right? This is a bucket load of fun, all right? So let's just sit back. And let's listen to Jingle Bells, done by the Air Force. We advertise for folks that for a few weeks that you want to come to Christmas Eve. We know a lot of families like ours celebrate their Christmas on Christmas Eve. And so we tell you, come as you are, all right? If you're all dressed up, like right here, wonderful. If you are already kind of casual and down for that, I even say you can come in your pajamas, all right? As long as you have a robe on. Well, I only saw two, and no Victoria's Secrets are allowed, all right? But I only saw two sets of pajamas, all right? So where's our, if we have more, but where's our two PJ kids? All right, stand up real quick. Stand up real quick. All right, show them what you got. All right. Here we go. Catch. All right, one for you. All right, that's peppermint kisses. All right, peppermint kisses. And now, along with those pajamas, they also got brand new Bibles. All right, so that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Terrific. Yeah, we're glad that you are here with us tonight. We have we always do a game before we get serious. We just like to have a little bit of fun. Actually, before I do the game, I came across a letter in a new book written by Max Licato. I came across a letter that a group of husbands wrote to their wives in preparation for Christmas shopping. And I know it's a little late for this year, but maybe it will plant some seed for next year. All right, let me read it to you. Dear ladies, we know y'all mean well. We know you think you know best. However, sometimes enough is enough. We have suffered in silence for too long. Having shared our pain with one another, we husbands hereby step up out of the shadows and open up our hearts. This year, as you shop for our Christmas gifts, please don't buy us what we need. We know we need to smell better and look nicer. We know you like us in warm pajamas and new underwear. But we do not know what to say when we open these gifts. How can you fake enthusiasm over house slippers? How can you look happy holding a nose hair trimmer? We've lied long enough. For the sake of integrity on Christmas morning, we offer this guidance. As you look at any potential gift, ask yourself these questions. Can he play with it? Does it swing, bounce, shuffle, cast, or roll? Can you find a trigger, grip, ripcord, or stick shift? Does it consume oil or dog food? Does it have a big screen and a remote control? If it does, buy it. Doesn't matter that he already has one. There is no time to be practical. When considered an item of men's apparel, ask yourself, is it brown and green and rain resistant? You can't lose with any garment that is. You're liking this, aren't you? Yeah, all right. Now I just lost my place. Realizing that many women prefer to shop anywhere but the gun department, we offer these two questions. Does it make him look cute? Does it make him look like a honk? If the clothing makes him look cute, run immediately. If it makes him look like a honk, buy two. When all else fails, ask, can he eat it? Note, the question is not, would you eat it? Or do other humans eat it? Or is it edible? Don't occupy yourself with trivialities. The question is, can he eat it? Anytime the answer is in the affirmative, consider yourself on very safe ground. In closing, we extend this offer. If you will buy us what we want, we will do the same for you. Without revealing any details, we will tell you this. A large vacuum cleaning company has offered us a group discount. And you thought we were insensitive. No need to thank us. Your husbands. All right, guys, thanks. In just a minute, we're going to sing a couple of Christmas hymns. But I just want to talk about a couple things very quickly. First of all, I have a few prayer requests. I'm not going to do what I normally do on a Sunday morning. We'll do that tomorrow. By the way, services are 9:30 and 10:45 tomorrow. No 8 o'clock. 1 hour services, 9:30, 10:45 in the morning, all right? It's another come as you are on Christmas Sunday morning. Three specific prayer requests that I'm going to make it for this evening. First off, Jordan, where are you? Stand up, Jordan. I know you get tired of me doing this, but some of these folks don't know you. They're from out of town visiting. This is one of our high school students. She's having surgery on Tuesday. All right, this is the fourth one, all right? And so it's outpatient. She'll be going home, but it is painful, and we're hoping to get to an end to it. And let's hope this one is it. And so we'll be praying for you, Jordan. Second of all, Larry Baumeister. Larry's wife, Rose, is a regular attender here, and I've known Larry for a long, long time. Larry comes and goes with his wife out of church. He works a lot of weekends and just not often able to be here. Larry right now is in the ICU unit at Clovis Community Hospital. They thought he had a stroke. He just dropped at work. Has not been responsive since then. That's the bad news. The good news is it's been diagnosed as one, pneumonia, and number two, meningitis. So he is under heavy antibiotics right now. I texted with Rose right before the service, and they have been able to take the, he's no longer intubated, and he is breathing on his own without the support of any equipment. So that is good news, but still waiting for him to become responsive. So tough thing to be going on in their family at this particular time. And so I want you to be praying for the Baumeisters. And then I want you to be praying for Clovis West High School. And particularly, I want you to be praying for the Fernando family. Their son, their only son, took his own life just a little over a week ago. And this is the third one this semester, the fourth one going back to the summer, all from Clovis West. And so we want to be praying for that school, for that faculty. For many of the parents that are there, they'll be very much aware. I had no idea until Thursday late afternoon that I might be doing his memorial service, but we will be holding that here at New Hope on Wednesday. And so I spent some time with the family Friday afternoon. This is their only son. Dad is Filipino. He's from the Philippines. He's a doctor. He's a physician here in town. He's an internist. Just a delightful gentleman. She is from England. She has that thick, heavy accent. I asked him, I said, "You ever get tired of listening to that accent?" And he said, "Yes, I do." Was not the answer I was expecting. But actually, just a very, very sweet couple. But can you imagine how they are feeling today? They waited 10 years after they were married to have a child. This is their only child. The note that he left is a mind-boggler. "Mom, Dad, I love you so much. You've been the greatest parents. My life has been wonderful. Okay? I just can't imagine my future being better than my past. Breaks my heart." And if you are here and you are a student, you are a teen, I want you to know your future is brighter than your past. Okay? Your future is brighter than your past. Christ can make all the difference in the world. And don't let a bad day or a bad week, because you need to understand, he thought he was doing his parents a favor. Really, in his mind, he thought he was doing his parents a favor. You are not. He has left his parents devastated. And so I need your prayers as we prepare for Wednesday, for the kids who will be there, his friends, the parents who are going to be there, for school personnel. This time it's educators. It's educators coming to my turf. Okay? We're limited on what we can say when we go to their turf. And so pray for us that we say what's right, because they need to understand there is a purpose that is higher than just education. And so be praying for this family, please. So those are those are the names that I want you to remember. So for Jordan and for Enzo, Enzo's family, Enzo Fernando, his family, and for Larry Baumeister, if you would be remembering them, I'd appreciate it so very, very much. Would you join with me while we just take a moment to pray for them? Our Father, I love you. I thank you so much, and I never love you more than at moments like sitting with the Fernando family when, from a human perspective, I have absolutely nothing to share with them. But Father, in knowing you and in trusting you for the words at those moments, there is hope. There is hope for that husband and wife. There is hope for these students who are looking at fellow students who have made some choices that have devastating effects. And so, Father, we pray that as members of this community, that we would be available to be used by you to be of help and hope and encouragement to families. We pray for our teachers and our counselors and our administrators. Give them a sensitivity that, Father, may not be natural for them. They may not have learned it in school or through their education. But, Father, may they discover that which comes from you and find the resources to reach out to these kids. Father, we pray for Larry Baumeister. We pray for his family. He's got grandkids and his daughter and his son. And this is not the way they, just a week ago, they expected their Christmas to be. And so, Father, we pray. We pray for your best to be available for them. And however you can use any of us to be of help and hope, may you find us available. And for Jordan, Lord, thank you for a young lady who loves you so much and shares her love for you with her friends, and she makes a difference in the lives of others. And thank you for her faith in you that makes a difference as she goes through this time of challenge and difficulty in her own life. And we just pray for your absolute best and presence to be at work in her. In Christ's name we pray, amen and amen. Just two quick questions. I'm only going to take a couple of answers, and you guys get hesitant to answer questions. But sometimes you'll share something that will be very, very helpful with somebody else. So here's a question. What was the best thing that's happened to you since last Christmas? What is the best thing that has happened to you since last Christmas? Somebody just want to pop off? Yes. You got a daughter-in-law, yes. And you know what I told your son when he introduced you to me? I said, don't mess this up because he won't do that well again. Okay? All right. He married you. Good job. Congratulations. All right. I remember when you got married. Yeah. Yeah. It just made me feel really old. All right. Somebody else. Yes. Coming back to church. Yeah. That's a good one for me, too. It's good to see you. Okay? Somebody else had a hand that go up over here.
Yes, my wife and I celebrated our
50th anniversary. Woo! That's right. That's right. And I don't know how you did that because she's only 55. So I'm, yeah. That was fun. That was a great night. Thank you. That was fun to do. Yeah. For those of you who don't know, that is my dad, and dad is 91, all right? He's working on 92, so we had another Christmas together, and on the heels of that, I'll say not only that dad is still alive, but he got to celebrate a Christmas with his first great-grandchild tonight, all right? So we've had Bo added to our family, so that's been great fun. Yeah, so I'll hand over here. Yes, yes. Yeah. You got a puppy? All right. What kind? Bird dog? A who? Oh, okay. Somehow anything with poo at the end just doesn't sound good for a dog. All right, it just doesn't sound great. All right, yeah, back here. Uh-huh. Oh, you got good neighbors then. Yeah, at least with Mikey, anyway. All right. Oh, Rod's not, yeah, Rod's not. Yeah, what did you get?
Two cows.
Two cows. All right. Do you know that in Ivory Coast, Africa, you could get you a wife with those two cows? Yep. One of our young ladies, man offered 2 cows for her, all right, from our church. All right, that's a true story. Yeah, where to see? Another one? Right back there, yes. Say it out loud, outside voice. All right. Your baby brother was born. Oh, that's good. Mama's holding him right there. All right. He's got his PJs on, too. I missed that one. All right. Terrific. All right, second question. Last question. What is or was your favorite Christmas tradition? What is or was? You can take one out of the past or one currently involved. What's a favorite Christmas tradition for you?
Making bread
with you and your mom. All right. All right. Oh, and your daughters, 3 generations now.
And my dad's testing.
All right. Very good. Do you girls really help, or do you just kind of watch? Okay. All right. Good. Just checking. Yes. Baking a gingerbread house. All right. Yeah. Do you know, I never did that in my life. How many of you have never made a gingerbread house? Raise your hand. Okay. I don't feel so bad. All right. Good. Thank you. You made me feel better. Okay. Yes. Family tradition.
Biscotti.
I like your biscotti. By the way, I'm out. Okay. Yes.
Shooting with the platoon.
All right. Military guy. All right. Good. One of my favorites the last 18 years has been right here. Being with you on Christmas Eve. All right. It's always great fun. Often, I'm thinking about an hour before, why did I do this again this year? Okay, we've just finished up with our family. Why did I do that? And after I get here, I'm always so glad to spend it with you. So thank you very much. The band's going to, they're there. I thought you left me, but okay, no, they're there. All right, they're going to lead us in a couple of our traditional Christmas hymns. I think we're doing Silent Night and Joy to the World, if I recall, Joy to the World with a little different twist. And so I want you to remain seated while we sing. The words are going to be up on the board. We've got some ushers here, and they're going to take an offering this evening. If you are a visitor or a guest, you can keep your money in your pocket. We're grateful to have you here. But I get church folks who tell me, I'm not going to be here tomorrow. Can I put my offering in tonight? Now, if you just got to get that tax-deductible contribution in and you're visiting, then you can do that. That's okay. But please don't feel compelled to do it. It's just primarily for our church family. So, Steve, come on over to the middle. All right, here we go. Now that is an ugly Christmas sweater. Turn around. You got to see this. I didn't know we had that contest going tonight. Wow. All right. Yeah, your wife gave you that, didn't she? Yeah. All right. All right, let's give thanks and then we'll sing. All right, Father, I love you. Thank you for our time tonight, and thank you for the fact that we can enjoy each other's company, we can laugh a bit, and then we can look at the most important event that's ever happened in the history of the world. We can reflect on the greatest gift that's ever been given, and the sad thing about the greatest gift ever given is not everybody accepts it. Not everybody receives it. And so, Father, I pray that even if tonight there's someone here who's never received the gift of your Son, that gift you gave 2,000 years ago, this might be a night that will make all the difference. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to share with you in the closing 12 or 13 minutes of our time together a divestiture.
Have you ever heard of divestiture before? Do you have any idea what a divestiture is?
Yep.
Cecil does, yeah. It's a cross between a devotion and a message. See, a devotion is supposed to be 5 minutes, and a message is supposed to be 30 minutes. This will not be 5, and it won't be 30, all right? It's going to be about 12. So this is going to be our Christmas Eve divestiture tonight. And I can't take credit for most of what you're going to hear. There's a new book out by Max Lucado called Because of Bethlehem. And there was a particular part in there that was so good that I thought I wanted to share it with you tonight. And so this is what we will wrap up with tonight. Christmas is a season of interruptions. Some we enjoy, some we don't. We enjoy interrupting our diet for eggnog. We enjoy interrupting work for a staff party and bill paying for Christmas cards. But we could do without the Chicago snowstorm that grounds an Atlanta flight which strands the passengers in Albuquerque, New Mexico. We could do without the midnight phone calls from Cousin Bert saying that he and Mary Lou and the kids are going to be in the area for the holidays. Could they park their Winnebago in your driveway? Oh, we promise we won't stay more than 10 days. Interruptions. They come with Christmas. They come with life. Just when you sell the crib, surprise! Another baby. Just when you're ready to retire, surprise! More tuition. Just when you thought your plans were finalized, surprise! More layoffs, surgery, transfers, and treatments. Interruptions. They can stir fear and anxiety. They steal our sleep and they pickpocket our joy. They can cause us to question God. For some, they even turn away from God. You may be facing an interruption in this season of your life. What you wanted and what you have received, they do not match. And now you are troubled and you are anxious. You might even be a little bit angry. Does that possibly describe any of you? It certainly described Lucado's family last Christmas. It was the second week of the Advent season. They had spent the day preparing for and speaking at Saturday night church. By the time he arrived home, it was well into the evening hours, and Dinelin, his wife, was waiting for him in the kitchen. I could tell by her expression, Lucado said, that something was not right. Max, Jenna is pregnant. Her announcement did not match her demeanor. Dinelin should have been waving her arms and hugging me, grandparents at last. But there was no confetti. There was just concern. Her eyes brim full of tears. Matt, our daughter's in the ER. We jumped in the car and raced to the hospital. Emergency rooms do not wear Christmas decorations well. A garland does not make an x-ray machine festive. Red and green bulbs cannot shed a happy glow on a gurney. No matter the song on the intercom, the monitors beep louder than the sleigh bells ring. An ER is still an ER, even at Christmas. And our daughter was in the ER. A nurse led us down the hallway into a room, and Jenna was on the bed, and she tried to be stoic, and she succeeded for about 10 seconds. And then she began to weep. She wanted to surprise the family. She wanted to make a big deal out of a Christmas pregnancy. She wants to have a baby. By the end of the night, we know a baby's not likely, and by the next morning, the doctor assured us it was not to be. It had already been a tough season for Jen and her husband, Brett. His dad had died a month earlier, and their November was gray with sorrow, and now December was going to be even darker. Jenna said her Christmas felt more like a hole in her day rather than a holy day. Maybe yours feels the same. Maybe there's more tears than cheers, more yuck than yule. The sight of happy children is a reminder of a vacant crib. The busy social schedule of some only highlights how empty yours has become. Images of families together reinforce your pain of a family apart. If this season is hard for you, if you're looking forward to December 26th more than you did to December 25th, then I have a story for you to consider. This is a story of a young girl. As much as she tries to keep a good attitude, it's not easy. She's far from home, miles from her family in her own bed. She spent the last days on crowded roads during the winter chill. Money is scarce and friends are nowhere near. A warm bed and a hot meal. Ooh, the prospects were slim for her. Ask her which is worse, the pain in her heart or the pain in her back. She'll be hard-pressed to make a choice. Her heart aches for her family. She feels estranged from them. Under normal circumstances, they would have been thrilled to have learned of her pregnancy. But pregnant before the wedding? with her conservative family and bizarre explanation, to have to tell the man she was to marry she was carrying a child and it wasn't his. It was a miracle he still married her. And another miracle is what she needs Christmas Eve. She's envisioned giving birth at home. Mom holding one hand and aunt the other, a midwife present. Doting
relatives, Joseph and a crowd of neighbors just hanging outside the door. Perhaps if they all could have experienced the birth of her firstborn together, then maybe they would believe her story. At least, that's how Max envisioned Mary felt. Of course, he could be wrong. Perhaps the feed trough and the stable were Mary's idea after all. I'm not thinking so. I've yet to meet a mother-to-be who dreams of using a cow stall for a delivery room and a manger for a bassinet. I doubt Mary did either. So when Joseph returned from the inn and asked, "Honey, are you allergic to sheep?" it's a safe hunch to say she was chagrined. This wasn't how she planned to celebrate the birth of Jesus. Joseph led the donkey down a steep path and ended at the mouth of a cave carved out by years of the wind and rain, used as long as anyone could remember as a barn. He lowered Mary off the back of the donkey. He looked in her face. She was fatigued and powdery from the road. He apologized for the austere accommodations. She touched his cheek and smiled, and she entered the grotto. Joseph built a fire and he heated water. Mary cleared a spot in the straw, and she set about the task of bringing God into the world. With cows as her witnesses and Joseph as her midwife, she did just that. Within moments, the hand of the star hanger clutched Mary's finger. The feet of the skywalker lay in Joseph's palm. No wonder the angels filled the sky with worship. Any doubt of the Father's love disappeared the night that God was wrapped in barnyard towels so that hay wouldn't scratch his back. In that moment, Mary knew it's all been worth it. The ache in her back and the ache in her heart, they faded away. The question of how, the wonderings of when, they didn't linger. The inn had no place for her son. That was all right. He would find a place in people's heart. She and Joseph were far from home on the night of Jesus' birth, but that was all right. Jesus was even farther from his. There was no warm bed in which Jesus could sleep. No problem. In spite of the chaos, Christ came. Through a scandalous pregnancy, an imposed census, an untimely trip, an overcrowded inn, God triumphed in Mary's story, and he triumphed in Matthew's genealogy. We don't often mention the lineage of Jesus in the context of his birth, but Matthew, check it out in the gospel, he did. He opens his gospel with a list of dozens of names. Before he presents the wise men and the star of Bethlehem, he tells us that Abraham begot Isaac, and Isaac begot Jacob, Judah begot Perez, and Perez begot... Milo, you're in Matthew's genealogy. And Hezron begat Ham. The list goes on and on for 16 verses. Obed and Jesse, Jesse the David the king. David the king begot Solomon. Oh, put me to sleep. Let's skip to the nativity story. Who needs to know about Tamar and Rahab and Ruth? Why does Matthew mention David and Solomon before he mentions Joseph and Mary? He's making a point. Chaos cannot keep Christ out of this world. The Messiah was born not because of who his ancestors were, but in spite of them. Tamar, she was abandoned by her family. Ruth, she was an immigrant. Rahab, she was a hooker. David was an adulterer and Solomon a philanderer. The family tree of Jesus was gnarled and crooked. And some of the kings and godless, yet God had promised that Jesus would come. And guess what, folks? Jesus came. Hence the triumphant conclusion of the genealogy. Jacob was the father of Joseph, who married a woman named Mary, and it was Mary who gave birth to Jesus, and Jesus who is the Savior and the Anointed One. Christ came. In spite of sin and scandal, he came. In spite of racism and sexism, he came. Though the people forgot God, Christ did not forget them. In spite of and out of pandemonium, Christ came. The surprise pregnancy, the sudden sentence, the long road from Nazareth to Bethlehem, unpleasant and difficult, yet they resulted in the world's greatest miracle. And Mary brought forth the firstborn son. And she wrapped him in swaddling clothes. And she laid him in a manger. Everything prior to this happened at this moment would happen. It was the first, was the first Christmas different from what Mary had planned? You bet it was. But it turned out greater than she could have dreamed. God used the struggle to accomplish his will. Don't we need that reminder? In our world of short nights and hard work and high stress, don't we need to know that Jesus holds us together? You might relate to the jalopy I once saw. The car clattered down the freeway, one door missing, the hood dented, it needed paint badly. On the loosely hanging bumper was this sticker: "Honk if anything falls off." For everything, Colossians, that Paul wrote, says Colossians 1, these words: "For everything, absolutely everything, above and below, visible and invisible, rank after rank after rank of angels, everything got started in him and finds its purpose in him. He was there before any of it came into existence, and he holds it all together right up to the moment." God holds us together. Everything inside of us and every voice around us says, get out, get angry, get drunk, get high. But don't listen to those voices. We cannot face a crisis right if we do not face God first. Paul said in Philippians 4, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. If you do this, you will have God's peace, which is far more wonderful than the human mind can understand. His peace will guard our thoughts and our hearts and give us rest as we trust in the Lord. Cling to him in the middle of the ICU. Say to him, Lord, encourage me. Dear Jesus, lift me up. During the deposition, when others are grumbling beneath their breath, may you be overheard praying, God, you are good. I need you. As Lucado was wrapping up this book, a pastor by the name of Saeed Abedidini, he spent his third Christmas in an Iranian prison. He's a former Muslim who converted to Christianity in the year 2000. With this, let me close. He sent a letter to his family. Here's what he wrote. He said, these days are very cold here. My small space beside the window is without glass, making the nights unbearable to sleep. The treatment by fellow prisoners is also quite cold and at times hostile. Some of my fellow prisoners don't like me because I am a convert and a pastor. They look at me with shame as someone who has betrayed the former religion. The guards can't even stand the paper cross that I have made and hung next to me as a sign of my faith. They have threatened me and forced me to remove it. This is the first Christmas that I am completely without my family. All my family is in another country. These conditions have made this upcoming Christmas very hard, very cold, and very shattering. It appears I'm alone, no one left beside me. The minister sounds understandably disheartened. Yet as he continues in his letter, he describes what he's beginning to realize. And he says, these cold and brittle conditions made me wonder why God chose the hardest time of the year to become flesh, and why he came to earth in the weakest human condition as a baby. Why did God choose the hardest to be born and the coldest time? His prison conditions reminded him of the birth of Jesus. Christ's birth happened at the hardest place, in the weakest human condition. The stable, like that man's prison, was cold, filthy, and unsanitary. Abedidini's letter shifts in its tone, exhorting us that the difficulty of Christ's birth can inspire us to face our own challenges with courage. We should be able to tolerate the cold and the difficulties, he writes, and the shame in order to serve the Lord. We should be able to enter into the pain of a cold, dark world. And then he goes on to say, it may be that we will be called fools and traitors and face difficulties, but we should crucify our will and crucify our wishes even until the world hears and tastes the true meaning of Christmas. I try to imagine this sturdy saint writing words of faith in a windswept, chilly cell. I envision him huddled in a corner, trying to stay warm, wanting to stay strong. He has little protection from the elements, and even less from his enemies. Christmas to him is very far from the idea of sleigh bells and carolers. It is to him a reminder of how far Christ came and how far Christ will go to help us. Christmas means that God came so that he could enter our hearts, transform our lives, replace our pain with what we just sang about, indescribable joy. In his difficult December, Abeta Denny received the greatest of Christmas gifts. He has a deeper appreciation for the sacrifice of Jesus. May you and I this Christmas have a deeper understanding of what Christ has done for us. I love the trees. I love the gifts. I love the music. I love my family. But do you love Christ best? Because he loves us best. Let's pray. Father, thank you for a season that's set aside so that we can reflect and remember. And Father, I pray that in the midst of all of our fun, in the midst of all of our thrills, that we understand that without the cross, the cradle means nothing. Without the blood, Bethlehem is an empty place. Without the resurrection, all of it would have been in vain. And so, Father, as we celebrate with each other, may we not forget, but may we have a deeper understanding of what the greatest gift is all about. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.